dentist and from the Pierre Fauchard Academy. But there is no degree which technically gives me the authority to go ahead and perform what is called SCD, which is special care dentistry. So what is the reason that Professor Naminini called me? The only reason I would like to believe is the experience. The number of years that I have actually been in this field is now 26 years. And why would this topic be so important? Why would we want to encourage all dentists to do special care dentistry? How many people would be requiring special care dentistry? What I mean to say is, what is the percentage of the population who require this? How many people have special abilities? When we look into statistics, it is quite astounding. Like if I give you the statistics in India, the number of people who are specially abled or they have intellectual disability is approximately 2% of the population, which in India accounts for 2 crores and 64 lakh of people. 2 crores and 64 lakh of people. That is 1 in 50 persons has got some sort of disability. So I guess more or less that should be the percentage in different parts of the world too. Now these, what would you call an intellectual disability? When you take into consideration the IQ of a person, it is below 70. If it is below 70, as you can see on the next slide here, if it is below 70, there is some sort of disability, which can be mild, moderate, severe, or profound. Now, I have been dealing with all these different strata of disabilities, that is mild, moderate, severe, as well as profound. Of course, as the IQ level goes down, the difficulty in treating these individuals becomes more. Now, these people, they definitely require medical help. Do they require dental help too? Definitely they require dental help. Dentistry for the intellectually disabled is what we call special care dentistry. Is it possible? Definitely yes. Is it required? It is a birthright of every individual that he or she, if in need of a medical help, should be rendered that help. So even if that person has got a disability which is profound, but that person has a dental pain, it is the moral responsibility of a dental surgeon that he or she should provide the dental care to that individual. Who are the people who can provide this dental care? All dental graduates and postgraduates sensitized to the special needs and requirement. I have underlined the term here, sensitized, because even if the person is a postgraduate, even if the person is a pediatric dentist or taken a diploma in special care dentistry, but is unable to connect because the person is not sensitized to the needs of these people with intellectual disability, then they will not be able to give this treatment. Is it that somebody is born with this ability to do? Obviously, it is not that way. Somewhere, somebody has to give you a push and then you get into this. So the beginning of my special care dentistry journey was in 1994, which is 26 years back, at J. Vakil School for Children in Need of Special Care, which is in Mumbai, India. But did I just walk into J. Vakil Foundation and start ask them that I want to be a dentist there? No. For any sort of different activity, there is obviously somebody behind it. Somebody who pushes you into it. Somebody who encourages to do that thing. And who was the man who pushed me into this? Was the man, Dr. A. Kumaraswamy. Dr. A. Kumaraswamy was the person who founded the dental clinic in the J. Vakil Foundation in 1988. And Dr. Kumaraswamy worked there for 3 years, rendering services to the people in that institute. Subsequently, since he was a consultant periodontist and also a much sought after speaker, he found it difficult to maintain his schedule at the J. Vakil Foundation. And so he asked me whether I could do it. And I said, let me give it a try. So he was the person who put me onto the special care dentistry path. And the institute where I went, the name which I mentioned, is the Jay Vakil Foundation and Research Center. It's a very big institute founded in 1945. That is just before India became independent. And what have they done in these 75 years? In 75 years, Jay Vakil is one of the largest and oldest non-profit institutes serving people with intellectual and developmental disabilities, as impacted lives of Black children and their families. They do all activities for rehabilitation. Obviously, the IQ test is done. And then based on the IQ level, they are put into different sections. And they are given the activities as per whatever will suit them. Whatever will suit them. So this is what Jay Vakil Institute does. And what was I doing there as a dentist? We were rendering dental treatment. In the first year of my experience in the institute, I worked twice a week for 2 hours each. And we would do everything from scaling and polishing, extractions, fillings, root canal treatment, where the IQ level is more or less okay. That is, we would say somewhere between 50 to 70, and they would cooperate for the treatment, and crown and bridge for them. So this was going on from 1994. And the story went on that way for a period of time, maybe about 10 or 11 years. And then came a major turning point in my journey of special care dentistry, which happened in the year 2005. The turning point came in February 2005. And what was the turning point? The turning point was the Special Olympics in Japan, which were the World Winter Games in Nagano, Japan. And in that year, the government of India selected three of us to represent the country at the World Winter Games. And as the dentist, they had different specialities like dentist, optometrist, audiologist, speech therapist, physiotherapist, podiatrist, and physicians. So from the dental faculty, the three of us went to Nagano, where we were formally trained for special care dentistry. The formal training happened 11 years after I actually started treating specially abled people. But then on paper, the training had to happen, and that happened in 2005. And the journey with the Special Olympics lasted for approximately 7 years. So that journey was from 2005 to 2012, during which time I was the out of the three clinical directors who got trained at Nagano. Unfortunately, two of them were not very active, one because of age and the other because of too many other commitments. So I was the only clinical director who was looking after the activities of Special Olympics Bharat in India for these 7 years. And since I was already lecturing and I had to travel around, I had already put a request that we should have more clinical directors in India. But that was the period when there was global recession. And Special Olympics, being based out of the United States of America, they were unable to fund that training, and so it never happened. Finally, in 2012, after several requests of mine, instead of taking the prospective clinical directors from India to a location where the games may be happening, they brought a trainer from Malaysia to Mumbai, and we trained 12 dentists from different parts of the country to get qualified as clinical directors for Special Olympics. Professor Nami Neni was one of them. And we were friends even before that. But after that, the bond has been much stronger. So that was the journey of Special Olympics. And after these 12 new clinical directors came in, I took a back seat. And after that, I have not been very actively involved with Special Olympics India. But what about the journey with Jay Vakil Foundation? The journey with Jay Vakil Foundation, which started in 1994, still goes on in 2020. So that is 26 years. But is it possible that somebody can last for 26 years in one single activity as a single individual? It's absolutely impossible. So there have been other people who have helped, who have lent a helping hand. Now we had made the visit once a week. So every Wednesday we go there and attend to the patients in the institute. And there are two lady dentists who help me in this activity. And these are the two ladies who are there. The one on the left of your screen is Dr. Khushbu Sehgal, and one on the right of the screen is Dr. Hiral Shah. They both are pediatric dentists practicing in Mumbai. And they both have been, Khushbu has been coming to the institute for the last 12 years, I think. And Hiral has been coming to the institute for the last 3 years. So with their help, we have been doing this work, executing different treatment modalities. Now I'll just run you through the basics of whatever treatment we do, what are the different things that we do so that we are able to deliver effective treatment for our special needs patients in the institute. The first and foremost thing, before we do anything, we ensure that we have what is called the medical emergency kit. If this is new to somebody, I would ask you to take a screenshot of it or take a picture of it, because these are the drugs and the last three are equipment that you need to have in your armamentarium before you touch any patient. Because all these special care dentistry, what we do is for people with special abilities or intellectual disabilities. We all know that they have not one, but many systemic complications, which can give rise to a medical emergency at any point of time. In case a medical emergency happens when the patient is on the chair and we do not have the kit with us, it can be disastrous. It can even be fatal. We all know that a majority of the intellectually disabled patients suffer from epilepsy. If a patient goes into gets an epileptic attack and we do not attend to it within 3 to 5 minutes, the patient may go into status epilepticus. And if that will last for 10 to 12 minutes, the patient will die. So the first slide which I am sharing with you of medical emergency is the most important thing. Without this, you should not be touching a single patient. When you have the kit with you, you can render treatment. But how do you render treatment to an individual who is not very cooperative, who may be in the profound category or severe category, where the IQ level may be below 40 and they are totally uncooperative? Then we take a treatment modality which was born very close to Kenya. It was born in Tanzania. That was called ART, which is atraumatic restorative treatment. Now we do not do exclusively ART or atraumatic restorative treatment. We do a slightly modern way of it, which is called a SMART, S-M-A-R-T, which is newer modifications of ART. In ART, only hand instruments were used. Here we use slow speed micromotors and also electric motors. If the patient is uncooperative, there are other ways to treat the patient, which is arresting of dental caries using a silver diamine fluoride. That technique is called a silver modified atraumatic restorative treatment. That is called SMART. We use pulp devitalizers and also direct pulp capping. Just to run you through the entire process, I will now share with you pictures of all these different modalities. And in case you are not aware about it, you can take a screenshot or you can take a picture with your smartphone and then Google the names and get the distributors, because I would not know exactly how it will be happening in Kenya. So the first thing, that is the use of motors. ART is actually an evidence-based treatment where only hand instruments are used for excavation of caries. But here I am talking about slow speed micromotor, which everybody knows about. But electric motors with electric handpieces are not very commonly seen. And what are they like? It is made by a company, Japanese company called NSK. And what we use in our practice is a NLX Nano. So you get an electric motor onto which you attach an electric handpiece. And what is the difference? The difference is that it can work at the speed of an aerotor. Also, it can work at the speed of a micromotor, or it can work slower. The speed can be adjusted from 10,000 RPM to 2 lakh RPM. So with an adjustable speed, if the child is a profound case, you can keep it at 10,000 or 20,000 RPM. And if the child is a mild case with the IQ of around 60 to 70, then you can keep it at a higher RPM, which can be 1.5 lakh to 2 lakh. So that's what is an electric motor, where the speed of the burr can be adjusted by you. These are expanding temporaries. Now, in case you get a patient who is totally uncooperative and you are unable to do anything, the least you can do is at least plug the cavity, plug the lesion. Now, the lesion should not be plugged with zinc oxide eugenol, because the zinc oxide eugenol will not last there for any number of days. If you plug it with a expanding temporary, which is a non-eugenol expanding temporary, then it will seal the borders of the cavity. It will give you a leak-free margin, and it will last for anywhere between 4 months to 6 months. Caviton is made by GC, and also you get something called Cavit, which is made by Dentsply. Now, in case the patient opens the mouth for a period of time, but the patient is not cooperative enough for you to move a motor within the carious lesion, what you can do is you can arrest the caries. You can arrest the caries by using what is called a silver diamine fluoride. ESDF is one product which is made in India. You have another product called Caries Arrest, which comes from the United States of America. You have another product called Phagamine, which comes from South America, that is Argentina. ESDF is very easy to procure. You can just go online and place the order, and it is courier to your clinic. Now, how do you use ESDF? You take it into a petri dish and you take it with the micro tip brush and rub it into the carious lesion for 60 seconds after you have dried it. For 60 seconds. After 60 seconds, you wipe it off with the cotton pellet, and the caries has been arrested. The carious lesion is over. It is not going to progress further into the dentine towards the pulp chamber. Only disadvantage of SDF is that it gives you a black staining. There is a discoloration. The tooth discoloration is permanent, but if it touches anywhere on the lip or the mucosa, any soft tissue, the discoloration gets reversed in about 15 days. So this is something you have to inform the patient prior to doing the procedure. So the step one was where the patient does not allow you to do anything, does not keep the mouth open for more than a few seconds. Then you seal the cavity with an expanding non-eugenol temporary, which is called Caviton. If the patient is partly cooperative, then you arrest the caries with silver diamine fluoride, which is ESDF. Disadvantage, it will cause black staining. Contraindication, you cannot use it if there is a pulp exposure. So as a clinician, you should be aware that whether it is a carious lesion restricted within the enamel and dentine, or whether it is extending up to the pulp. If it is extending up to the pulp, then we cannot use a ESDF. What you can do in an uncooperative patient where it is extending up to the pulp to give a pain relief is to use what is called a pulp devitalizer. There are many pulp devitalizers in the market. These are some of the common pulp devitalizers which are available universally. The one on the left is a Pulpex, which comes from previous Denpro. The one on the right is D-Pulpin, which is more universally available because it comes from a very famous company called Voco. So how do you use it? You excavate with the help of a spoon excavator, and then just clean out the cavity. If the patient is cooperative, use an electric handpiece and clean out the carious lesion. And then you put the pulp devitalizer, cover it with a small pellet of cotton, or crush some amount of Teflon tape, place it over the devitalizer and cover it with Caviton, which is a non-eugenol expanding temporary. Now, just in consider a scenario where the patient is cooperative and we have started excavating the caries, thinking it is just a carious lesion, not thinking that it is a root canal opening. The X-ray did not show that it is extending up to the pulp. So we start excavating the caries, and slowly as we have started excavating the caries, suddenly we realize that there is a pinpoint exposure. If there is a pinpoint exposure, the treatment modality that is being still taught in colleges, I believe, is that you seal the exposure with a calcium hydroxide. Research has now conclusively proven that a direct pulp capping should not be done with the calcium hydroxide, but it should be done with bioceramics. So what are the bioceramics which are universally available? A bioceramic is called a biodentine. Why should a bioceramic be used and how should it be used? Why it should be used? Number one, a bioceramic glass is the only material which shows setting expansion instead of setting shrinkage. So when it expands on a pinpoint exposure, it is going to seal the borders of that exposure and there is going to be no more leakage. Number two, it is bacteriostatic in nature. Number three, it stimulates the formation of odontoblasts and osteoblasts. So it will actually create the dentinal bridge, what we were taught and what was never happening till now. So these are reasons why a bioceramic glass is the material of choice for a direct pulp capping. Now, this direct pulp capping happens. Obviously, most of you may be pediatric dentists, so you know what happens where. But a direct pulp capping in the perspective of a iatrogenic exposure is what I'm talking about. So use a bioceramic glass. Now, all these procedures that we do will obviously be done under local anesthesia. Again, we will try and be safe. Like I said in the beginning, without a medical emergency kit, we would not be treating any patient. Now, why would an emergency kit be required? One is if the patient goes into an epileptic shock. Second is if they get an anaphylactic shock. The reason why patients get anaphylactic shock is because of the local anesthetic that we inject. The local anesthetics that come in vials, they have a preservative called methyl paraben. And methyl paraben is more likely to trigger an anaphylactic shock rather than the lignocaine or the articaine. So what we do now is instead of using local anesthetics in vials, we use local anesthetics in cartridges, which are these. The one here you see is a lidocaine, and the one this you see on the right is an articaine. These are two different molecules. You have another two molecules, which is a mepivacaine and a bupivacaine. But for a general dentistry and a pediatric dentistry, you are a normal, regular dentistry, you are not in need of bupivacaine and mepivacaine. They are used for more extensive surgical procedures like multiple implant placements or a full mouth flap surgery, or when you do oral surgical fracture reductions. Else, lidocaine and articaine should be more than enough. Sometimes we are asked, what is the difference between these two? They are two different molecules. Both are anesthetic. The difference practically and clinically is that the articaine onset of action is much faster. The profoundness of anesthesia is more than that of lidocaine. But we have been using lidocaine for many years. So there are a lot of clinicians who continue to use only lidocaine, and some of them who have preferred to shift on to articaine. As I mentioned from the beginning, medications and medicines are given maximum importance. What are the medications that we are talking about? That's the next slide coming up for you on medications. Continue with all existing medications. Whatever medications they are taking for whatever systemic conditions that they are suffering from, those medicines have to continue. There may be some times when the dentist is not sure about certain medications. If you are unsure, instead of just going through the drug on Google or any other site, it will be advisable that you refer the patient to the physician or neurologist, whoever is attending to this special abilities person, and ask them for the consent if required. If the patient suffers from epilepsy, which is very, very highly likely, then The patient is asked to take the anti-epileptic drug, which is most of the time phenytoin. Ask them to take it 1 hour prior to the procedure. Along with that, an alprazolam will be given based on the body weight. You can decide the dose what you want to give. What the alprazolam does is basically they will bring about a relaxation of all these skeletal muscles. And there are the chances of a patient getting into an epileptic attack is much lesser when an alprazolam is given rather than when it is not given. The antibiotics, antimicrobials, anti-inflammatories, and antacids are as per requirement. Just to run you through the choices which can be acceptable and which can be used by special abilities people, the antibiotics, we try and restrict ourselves to the basic, which is amoxicillin. As you all know, most of them, except the ones with cerebral palsy, have got very good immunity and very good resistance and very good recovery rate. So amoxicillin will do the job for most of them. If you are doing a root canal, you generally do not need to give antibiotic, but if you want to give, if the systemic conditions are many more than what expected, then you give an amoxicillin with a combination of a cloxacillin, or you can give an amoxicillin with a combination of potassium clavulonate. Ideally, we try and avoid getting into the potassium clavulonate category because it gives a lot of gastric irritation and they become very uneasy when we give them this combination. So plain amoxicillin is what we would say choice number one, and amoxicillin with cloxacillin would be choice number two. Some clinicians prefer to give a cefixam or a ciprofloxacin, which are all okay. If the patient is on anti-epileptic drugs, which has caused generalized gingivitis or periodontitis, and we have to treat that, then we would probably think of giving a cefadroxil. The cefadroxil works quite well on the soft tissues, and we would opt for that. What about the anti-inflammatories? Now, we need to take a little more amount of care than we would do with a normal patient, because here, the systemic conditions may not be always amenable to giving the ibuprofen or diclofenac, which we usually give. So a ketorolac or a pyroxicam will be drugs of choice. And what about the antimicrobials? The same two antimicrobials, that is metronidazole or ornidazole. Now, depending upon the antibiotic that we give, we decide what antimicrobial, if it has to be given. So if there is a certain doubt in your mind that there may be anaerobic organisms involved, you could go with an amoxicillin with the metronidazole, or if you are going in with a ciprofloxacin, you combine it with a ornidazole. Now we have drugs where the ciprofloxacin and ornidazole come as a single unit, so you go in for a combination. Now, COVID infections, the current topic everywhere is COVID because that is spread like nobody's business, spread all over the world, and I believe it's there in Kenya too. All standard safety measures to be implemented in the clinical practice to prevent the spread of the virus in the clinic or from your clinic to the outside. That is, it can spread to your patient, it can spread to your staff, from there on it can spread to their families and friends. So all standard safety measures, what we have heard for the last few months, how to prevent the spread of the disease, we have to implement in our practices. Build your immunity with proper nutritional substitutes, and that's how you can remain safe, because COVID is not going anywhere so soon. So for the next 6 months at least, we will have to take these standard precautions. And till the time that COVID is here, when we are treating persons with special abilities, that is when you're practicing special care dentistry, it is advisable that at least for that period of time, cover your cases with amoxicillin, at least, if not plain amoxicillin, amoxicillin with cloxacillin or amoxicillin with potassium clavulonate. So we believe that every child has a right to live a life of dignity. And we also believe that irrespective of their disability, we should respect what they are doing. And this is our institute, Jay Vakil Foundation, where we have our on the ground floor of this building, we have our dental unit, the dental clinic. We have a huge playground in front of it where we have the entertainment part, the sports activities happening for our children. And these are the indoor physical activities that happen. Rehabilitation, this is our occupational therapist who is working on some of the children in the rehab center. So we believe that we have to be committed to a more inclusive world, and we remain committed to that at our institute, which is the Jai Vakil Foundation. You can search for us on Google. We are there all over Google, Jai Vakil Foundation. And we strive to be more inclusive, make them realize that they are all part of the same world. This is me. I don't know how many of you recognize the other three in the picture. They are all from India. He is probably the greatest cricketing icon. The Kenyans would obviously know him, Sachin Tendulkar. And this is our national badminton champion, who is also now the world champion, PV Sindhu. And this is a film actress from India, Sonam Kapoor. Now, they have all pledged their support to Jai Vakil Foundation and for our project of inclusion. You can see it very clearly on PV Sindhu's band, the word inclusion. So inclusion means we are including the specially abled people in the general society. So we choose to include. Do you? Thank you very much. That is my email ID. And that's the WhatsApp number. You can note it down. So in case you have queries, I would obviously go, I'll go to the chat box, look for questions, and Professor Namineni would have some questions to ask me. And in case you do have queries post the event, you're welcome to either email me or WhatsApp me the questions, and I will be happy to answer them for you. I have tried to be brief because over these last 5-6 months, we have realized that when we do online programs, the attention span of an individual is never more than 30 to 40 minutes. So that is what we try to do, try to restrict between 30 to 40 minutes. And I have spoken exactly for 38 minutes. So I hope it was not very boring. And you would have probably got some points to take home from here. I'm going into the chat box and try to see if there are questions and I can make out something.
Thank you very much, Dr. Santosh. It was wonderful. And it's a great introduction to somebody who would always feel that you need a special training for special care needs dental treatments for children and adults. But the take-home message is, it's not the training, it's the heart and empathy. Somebody was asking about the foundation. I just typed in that it is Jai Vakil Foundation.
Yes.
Dr. Santosh, I have one.
Yes, please.
How do parents react and appreciate your efforts when they come to you with the children who are special?
The children with special abilities who come to us in the institute are a completely broad spectrum. Like, we have some who could probably buy our entire institute. I mean to say, they are that rich. Okay. And there are some who are from a very low income category, whom the institute is currently supplying even with food and medicines. So we have a very broad spectrum in terms of income who come in there. And approximately we have about 1,000 individuals in our institute whom we cater to in different categories. So the ones who are very rich or the ones who are very poor, they all become the same once they come there. And they are only concerned that the dental complaint of their child or ward needs to be addressed. If the child is very uncooperative, then we inform the parent that there are different options what you can do. Either you can take them to a pediatric hospital or like a hospital with a pediatric department where the treatment can be done under general anesthesia. But there will be some who cannot afford it, some who cannot take leave from their job to take the child multiple number of times to the hospital. And they are okay with the idea that you go ahead and physically restrain the child and do the treatment. So we would have to go ahead and do it. Of course, keeping in mind that our fingers can never go into the occlusion, else they may even bite it off. A lot of times it has happened to new people who treat them for the first time, they get bitten a lot of times. I have got bitten a couple of times in the early 90s when I had started. But then you know, your fingers are always within the vestibule, or mostly in the upper part, that is parallel to the upper six or seven, you put your thumb, your forefinger on the upper jaw and the thumb on the lower jaw, both in the vestibule, nothing goes into the occlusion. So that itself acts like a mouth prop and the child opens the mouth. And the parents are okay with it because they are only concerned that the child should get respite from the pain that he or she is suffering from.
Yeah. I have two more questions to you, Dr. Santosh. Number one, the Indian subcontinent and African countries share the same kind of economic and financial backgrounds. And how do somebody offset the resources, financial resources, to get involved with that kind of work? Number one. Number two, are you aware of any international associations who would chip in help when we have to involve ourselves with this kind of activity? That's the second question.
From the perspective of our institute, which is Jai Vakil Foundation, the dental clinic, the space for the clinic obviously was given by the institute, but the clinic was set up entirely by Dr. Kumar Swami. He donated the chair, the equipment, the instruments and everything. And that is how I could start working there. And since then, there is a lot of difficulty gaining funds for all this. So the funding of the clinic is done by myself. So whatever consumables are required, whatever materials are required, everything has been supplied by us since the last whatever number of years. The first 1 year, obviously, it was from the institute. After that, we have been giving it from our side. And as such, it is not such a big amount. It doesn't work up to such a big amount. And among all the, other than the two ladies whom I showed on the screen, there have been a few others who have wanted to come and work there, but all of them want to get paid for it, which is not feasible because rather than paying them, I would go and do the work myself. And also that gives me a high, gives a feel good factor rather than paying somebody to go there and work. So funding from outside sources is almost nil. In fact, in the beginning, when I showed the slide of Jai Vakil Foundation, it said Mumbai, Kamshet, that is Mumbai, Talegaon and Nasik, Devlali that is. In Talegaon, that is very close to Pune, the dental clinic which was set up there, I had sent an appeal to all my colleagues and friends, and a lot of them, different people donated different things, and we assimilated all that and set up a clinic there, which was functional from, I think, 2001 to 2011 for about 10 years. And in that institute also, though it was a combined institute, there we had Jai Vakil Foundation for special abilities people. We had the National Association of Blind. We had an institute for women who in dysfunctional families who want shelter. We had an orphanage and two, three other institutes, basically all such social welfare institutes. And we would render dental treatment not only to the Jai Vakil children, but also to their parents and also to all the other institutes and their parents. And even then, though it was known, in fact, I had sent the appeal letter to a lot of influential and rich people, but nobody actually comes ahead by giving funds. So it was just us doing the funding bit. So I don't know, at least that is my experience. If you're able to get funding, well and good. If not, then you should probably give it back because we are earning good amount of money from the practices. So it doesn't harm in giving back something to the society. I do not believe, I never go and give any money in a temple or a church or anything. So what money we give as charity is all into this activity.
Yeah, yeah, great, great. It's the heart, which is the pivot of the whole service, not just the money. If you have the heart, I think whatever little resources you need, then definitely they just come in. And the Dr. Nick, you're still there? Dr. Nick?
Nominally, sir, there are some questions in the question answer section.
Yes, I was just going through that. I saw one which asked whether we do treatment under general anesthesia. What happens here in India is that to do under general anesthesia, either we need to be attached to a hospital or we need to hire an operation theater in a nursing home. But to do that, you would obviously require all the portable equipment to go and operate. So what we do is, in case there are parents who want the children to be treated under general anesthesia, then the two lady pediatric dentists who I showed you in the slides, they are both attached to two different hospitals. So we take them either to that hospital, but those both are private hospitals. So it works. I mean, there's some charge to it. If the person cannot afford, then we have a tie-up with Nair Dental Hospital, where if the parent goes with the ward to Nair Dental Hospital, then all the treatment, including the general anesthesia, is done free of charge for them. Obviously, when they go with a covering letter from me. So that's the part about general anesthesia. And then there was somebody asking me about whether if the IQ is more than 70. If the IQ is more than 70, then it doesn't come under special care dentistry. It will go under normal dentistry. So we're not discussing that. But specifically, that person has asked about cleft lip and palate. Maybe Srini, you can do a separate lecture on that. Srinivas Namineni is widely acknowledged as the father of nitrous oxide sedation. So maybe these patients can be treated by Professor Namineni under nitrous oxide or laughing gas sedation.
Yeah, we have one coming up. And as far as the cleft lip and palate is concerned, we have a great resource person, Dr. Gayatri Moge, who is going to share experiences in the forthcoming lectures. Dr. Nick, anything from Kenyan Dental Pediatric Dental Association?
No, sir, some more questions are there. Can I read it out?
Yeah.
One question I saw. Electric motor to coolant. Am I right? Somebody has asked, what is the coolant in an electric motor to protect the pulp? The coolant is water. Coolant is water. The difference between an aerator and an electric motor is that in the aerator, there is air as well as water coming out. Whereas in an electric motor, there is only water that comes out. So water is the coolant.
Okay. There is a question from Ligali. Thank you so much for the brief but concise lecture. Do you do non-pharmacological and pharmacological behavior management techniques during management of these patients?
The one which I mentioned, except for alprazolam that we give for a patient who is a known epileptic, we do not give any other pharmacological support. And behavior management obviously is a completely different ballgame when you're dealing with special abilities people. Because what would be a normal behavior management techniques that we implement in regular pediatric dentistry may not be acceptable or may not be possible in these cases, because a lot of times as the profoundness increases, they obviously do not understand any of the things that you're going to tell them.
Okay. Are we dealing with the pharmacological and non-pharmacological behavior management in our forthcoming lectures? So it will be covered in a later part of the series.
Dr. Santosh, I have one question.
Yes, Shini.
When you mentioned that your attention is more towards non-pharmacological management, is the reason because you didn't realize the need of pharmacological management, or the setup what you have may not permit you to do effective pharmacological management? Can you throw a little light on that?
Both, actually both. What you say, both ways it is correct. Because a lot of times when we work in the institute, I would go there on Wednesdays, the patient comes in and they are already in pain and I would be, next visit will be next Wednesday. So we would do the extraction or whatever treatment that is indicated, even without an antibiotic or a painkiller. A lot of times that would happen. But only and only in case it is a known epileptic patient, then we schedule the patient for the subsequent visit with all those instructions to have the anti-epileptic drug and the alprazolam 1 hour prior. And the third would be, if you refer the patient for a sedation or for a general anesthesia, then it would go into a pharmacological.
Yeah, there is one participant, Dr. Islam Mahmood, who is asking that, I have a patient whose father has Alzheimer's. The complaint is that he grinds his teeth, causing his teeth to fracture. Can he wear night guard, or do you have any other suggestions?
See, if the patient is of Alzheimer's and is grinding, the first thing is, a lot of times the Alzheimer's patient would not be able to tell what is happening. So the line of treatment, first line of treatment obviously is in a regular patient also, we give something to clear the GIT. So there is a drug called nizonide. So nizonide 500 milligram is given twice a day for 5 days. Now if the patient is a non-Alzheimer and they have a GIT indication leading to grinding of teeth, then the nizonide will clear the gut and the grinding will stop. That is stage one. Stage two would be where we give a guard, where the thickness of the guard has to be minimum of 2 millimeters, because we have 0.5 millimeter, 1 millimeter, 1.5 and 2 millimeter. So we prepare the 2 millimeter guard, which the patient can wear. But, and that also can be done a maximum of 3 times, because in severe cases, they will grind through the guard and they will reach, I mean, the teeth start reaching again. Upper and lower will get in contact again. So you can make it a second time and you can make it a third time, but not more than that. If 3 guards are destroyed, then we suggest that the patient has to be taken to a psychiatrist for checking what is the psychiatric background. But if the patient is already suffering from Alzheimer's, we already know the psychiatric background. So obviously that cannot be treated at any case. Even if you give a night guard, the patient is going to grind through it. And then also there is a danger that the patient may actually swallow it and suffocate. So that's the danger of giving a night guard to a Alzheimer's patient.
Great.
How? There's one more question. Shreya Das Gupta has asked, SHCN children having compromised immunity, is GA rehabilitation a good option in COVID times?
GA is safe, but the problem again is the hospitals are not that safe. So unless it is absolute requirement that the patient has to visit a hospital, it is not advisable in COVID times.
Okay. Next question is, thanks for this is from Grace. Thanks for the lovely presentation. Please comment on the root canal treatment for special needs patient.
Root canal treatment for special needs can be done under local anesthesia up to an IQ level of 50 normally. Normally up to 50. But some of the special needs persons, particularly autistic, they may be very aggressive. And then there is the problem that you are apprehensive about putting a file into that patient's mouth. Then you get something called an eye grip. There is a instrument called eye grip. So that eye grip will ensure that the patient can never swallow the instrument, because that patient may not actually allow you to.
Can you spell out the eye grip? I will put it on the chat box.
It is written as a small I dash G-R-I-P, eye grip.
Okay.
It is an eye grip. That should be a good adjunct, good tool for you to do safe root canal. In case we feel that the patient is not going to be cooperative enough to sit through the entire biomechanical preparation till the time that you complete it. Normally, we would try and complete it in one sitting. But a lot of times, special care, special abilities, people do not sit for that much time. So what we do is then we put a pulp devitalizer and call the patient back the next time. And then you extirpate the pulp without an LA and the patient is more comfortable. So that's what we would do. Otherwise, Dr. Grace, we would go ahead with root canal just like we would go ahead with any other person. But if it is a profound case, then doing a root canal is almost impossible. You would have to do it under conscious sedation, which is legally not acceptable procedure, or a nitrous oxide sedation, or a general anesthesia, or you go ahead and extract the tooth.
Yeah, a couple of last questions. Would you throw some light on Special Olympics movement? I'm sure you are so passionate about Special Olympics, and you are one of the pioneers in the country of India in propagating special needs dentistry and Special Olympics in particular. Can you throw some light for the Kenyan colleagues so that
Special Olympics is big time in India. In fact, it is called Special Olympics Bharat. And Special Olympics Bharat is now tied up with the Indian Dental Association head office. So the activities of Special Olympics Bharat gets a boost because it is publicized through the Indian Dental Association journals and their bulletins and magazines, all of which currently is not coming in, but it is all there online. The person who is now heading the movement in India is Dr. Reena Kumar, who's based out of Delhi. And she's been doing an awesome job. In her college, she has established a department for special care dentistry, which is not very common to see in our country, where it is friendly for the physically challenged. You have the RAM.
Sorry for interruption. Can you throw some light on the international picture of Special Olympics so that the Kenyan colleagues will connect to it better?
Special Olympics is based out of America. Basically, it was started as a movement in the United States of America, and it is still based out of America, and it is headquartered in Washington. So if you go onto the site of Special Olympics and just put in a request that you want the movement to happen in Kenya, they will be more than eager to include you in the movement. And they will coordinate with you, help you in every possible way. The only thing with Special Olympics is that the funding has to be generated locally. They do not provide us with financial help, but they will provide us with their banner. They will provide us with teachers. They'll provide us with programs, and they will provide us with opportunities wherein in Kenya, you would obviously have institutes which are catering to rehabilitation of intellectually disabled people. So these people will get involved in the Special Olympics activities. They will have competitive games. So like, you know, you will have something between Nairobi and Mombasa and maybe the Masai Mara, everything. And Shini, I guess we should try and plan and go to Masai Mara. So when we go to Masai Mara, we will have a two-day workshop for all our Kenyan colleagues, and we will teach them. You can teach pediatric dentistry, and I will teach restorative dentistry.
That's a good idea. I think Nick will comment on it in private. Nick, is there anything else from Kenyan colleagues?
Sir, one question is there in question answer and chat box.
This is from Hafiz Hassan Santosh. Sir, is pre-medication a must for every epileptic patient? And what is the medicine you would prefer, and what kind of dosage you're looking at?
Whatever drug for the epileptic condition, most of the time they are taking phenytoin, or any drug, whatever their physician has prescribed for the epilepsy has to be taken 1 to 2 hours prior to sitting on the dental chair. And along with it, we give them an alprazolam or any other sedative, whatever may be there in, because earlier it was diazepam. Now diazepam is not that freely available. So we give them alprazolam. It is better so that the epileptic attack should not happen when the patient is on the chair.
Okay. Yeah, Dr. Balaji, I don't know whether our Kenyan colleagues are
from the Kenyan side. I think the questions have been asked and answered. Yes. That was a wonderful presentation, Dr. Santosh.
Thank you.
And you also had some viewers from the Facebook group, but okay. So we don't have any questions on that side.
Okay. I think with that, we'll probably consider concluding this session. Thank you very much, Santosh. I'm sure with the take-home message is not just the training. Training is just part of it, but heart and empathy. I think that's what we all need to take home. Thank you very much. And thank you very much for sharing your experiences.
Thank you. Thank you, Srini.
And Dr. Priya.
Thank you, Srini. Thank you, Priya. Thank you, Dr. Balaji. Thank you, Kenyan Association of Pediatric Dentistry.
Thank you, Nick. Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone.